Coming up on today's show.
I knew I needed to come back to God, but I didn't want to come back to God and have my life the same as it was before I left. I knew I would need to be different, and I just didn't think I could be different.
And I saw Tammy and said hi to her, you know, an acquaintance, and come to find out later that when she did that, she had butterflies in her stomach.
All of that and more on today's show.
Welcome to the program. I'm Reverend Steve Ballard, a minister here at Grace Cathedral, and this is my lovely wife, Kathy. On today's program, we have a beautiful couple joining us from Grace Cathedral.
And they are going to share with us how God has blessed them in a great way with miracles and healings, and they've blessed their marriage as well. Welcome to the program, Mike and Tammy. It's so good to have you with us.
Thank you. It's
Thanks
good
for
to
having
be here.
Us.
Now, both of you have been in the ministry for almost, well, for you, Mike, it's been over 50 years and close to 50 years for you,
right.
Tammy.
Mm-hmm.
And we want to know how you were first introduced to Grace Cathedral. So, Mike, we're going to start with you.
Okay. Well, I was 6 years old, and I'd had kidney problems for pretty much all my life, kidney disease. And my parents had been searching for a way to try and get my healing or miracle. My mom believed that there was something there, but didn't really know. And we had a little shepherd that introduced us to the church, and they brought us when I was six, which was back in 1969. And I got my miracle right on the platform. My parents got saved, and I've been coming ever since. So I've was raised from a little bit over. I missed some of the early Sunday school, but I did go through some of the later Sunday school. And once we came in as a family, my parents were in all the way.
All the way.
And after Reverend's wife, Angel, passed away, my mom took over the choir. So we'd only been here for a couple years when she took over the choir. She was quite young at the time to take over Angel's choir. But, you know, they, like I said, they got in all the way. We were at every service. We never missed a service. My parents wanted to raise us the right way, and I'm very, very thankful for that.
So if it wasn't for that miracle, would you be here today?
No. I was about to lose one kidney. The other was already diseased, starting to get diseased, and I would have had to go to dialysis at best case. And in those days, dialysis isn't what it is today. And, it's pretty much confirmed that I wouldn't be around.
And today. You actually have medical proof that
yes.
your kidney was recreated. What
yes.
did the doctors say when they looked at the x-rays?
They were fascinated. I mean, they didn't know what happened. And I was quite young, I don't remember, but I know my dad saying that the doctor came in and spread the x-rays on the floor and said, this is what the kidney looked like before. And now it looks like this. It's like a brand new baby's kidney born. You know, it's actually a little smaller than the other. It's still developing. And he just could not figure out what happened.
It was an all-out miracle.
It was an all-out miracle.
And he couldn't dispute it
right.
because there it was in the x-rays. He could see it
right.
for
and,
himself.
Reverend always said that was one of the first great recreative miracles that had happened. And there was obviously lots of other healings and everything in his, but that one to be just all out such that they had the medical proof and with the kidney that looked smaller was just phenomenal. And I've been healthy all of my life. You know, I've not had a lot of other illnesses. And I once told Reverend, he says, pray for what you need. I said, I really don't have anything. And he just told me that was such a powerful miracle that has worked in your life, from the time you were a kid to now. So I've really had no other illnesses, colds, you get stuff like that, but nothing else is.
And Tammy, how did you come into the ministry?
When I was in high school, my first year in high school, a friend of mine had invited me on a hayride. They used to do events, and outings for the youth group back then. And I had plans for that Saturday evening. It was on a Saturday, but I had other plans, but they fell through at the last minute. And so I decided just to go ahead and, you know, go with her to the hayride. And I went on the hayride, met lots of young people from the church, and she invited me to a service. And I believe it was the very next morning I came. So that was 1972. And I've been coming really ever since. So that's how I got started.
It wasn't really by accident that other engagement fell through.
I really believe that. I think back on that a lot, and I'm sure God intervened there somewhere. So I'm really thankful that.
So you had fun on the hayride, fellowship, and you met some young people, and all of a sudden you, I want to try church.
Up to that point, I mean, were you familiar with, you know, God
and
His ways?
I had no background at all. My parents, we lived down the street from a little church, and I think I went on Easter. I remember dressing up one Easter and going to church, but I knew there was a God, and I mean, I believed. I must have known enough to realize. I always knew there was a heaven, and I believed there was a hell, and that's about all I knew. But when I first, you know, came, I didn't know anything about God, so.
So you didn't know about the born-again experience?
No, I didn't.
About living free from sin?
I didn't know what any of that meant. As a matter of fact, I remember telling the friend that, you know, that invited me when I was hearing in the services about salvation. I didn't understand because I really had never gone out in sin, and I was a pretty good kid, you know, growing up, and I didn't really know what sin was, what the difference in being a sinner and someone who was saved, born again through the blood of Jesus. I didn't know what
the
difference was.
Did it take you a couple times to go to church before you accepted Jesus?
It took me a little while before I really understood when I accepted Christ and became born again, what that meant, how my life needed to change. Because like I said, I wasn't really out in sin or anything. So I just needed to learn how to, you know, be what God wanted me to be and how to go on and receive the baptism and let God's will be done in my life. I just more along those lines and rather than coming from sin at that time.
Right.
So after you received salvation, did you just start seeking for the baptism?
I did. It took me a while to understand what it was about, but I listened in the services and I read in the Bible about it, and I learned. I asked a lot of questions, and I received, you know, the Holy Ghost, and somewhere along the line, I kind of slipped away from that.
And what happened?
Excuse me. Well, I quit
that situation.
When I first came in, and you know, we were taught to do our prayer time, how important that was to read the Word of God, and fasting and praying, and I had never done any of that. As a matter of fact, the fasting, I kind of had to fight with my parents about that. They didn't understand why I would go missing a meal, so I didn't really get to do that as much as I wanted to at the time.
I think, you know, new people in families, if you're just the only one saved in your family, you kind of experience that.
Yeah.
I know I've seen it even in Kathy's family where, you know, they didn't understand that, you know, about her fasting. Some of her family members, others were already saved.
That was the hardest part for my parents. They didn't mind me going to church. You know, they were okay with that. But I only lived probably 12, 15 minutes from the original Grace Cathedral in Akron. But I'd never heard of the church. I'd never heard of Reverend Angley or anything. So they were fine, though, when I started coming. Just they didn't understand not eating.
Right.
You know, they didn't understand that.
It can be confusing for some people, but it's strictly biblical.
Yes.
And if you do it the right way, God will be with you and He'll help you through it.
And they saw later in my life how I would continue to do that, and they realized it was okay.
And God knows your heart, and, you know, when you're trying to make that sacrifice and you're fasting those meals, you know, he knows that, you know, you're making that sacrifice for Him to go deeper in the Lord.
Right. So, I just kind of quit. I backed off on my prayer time. Mm-hmm. I got busy with school, and I wasn't keeping up with that the way I should. And so then I would miss a service because I had something else I needed to do. And that kind of snowballed, I think, and just
drew you away.
Drew me away from God, and I was in the choir at the time, and I held on to, that was the last thing I was holding on to before I was coming and staying in the choir because I was afraid if I quit the choir, then I was going to leave completely and maybe not get back. I don't know. So I couldn't stay in the choir and sing the songs I was singing. And I felt like a hypocrite because mm-hmm. I wasn't serving God right. the way I needed to.
And Reverend wants everyone that's in the choir or on the platform
to
be filled with the Holy Ghost
right.
and let that anointing go forth.
That's right.
And we all know that, those of you that are on the platform. So when you're kind of, in that gray area or falling behind
and you're not
doing your prayer time and it's showing up to you on you and you know the devil's fighting you and then you have a choice to make.
I didn't want to be a hindrance mm-hmm. to others. I didn't want anyone else to be affected by maybe what I was doing. So mm-hmm. I got away from God and I was really only out of church probably a year, maybe less really. It was about 10 months, mm-hmm. but
I mean, how bad did it get for you during that time?
It got bad. I knew I needed God, but I wasn't where I should have been, I believe, with God when I first came into the ministry. And the devil just really, really gave me thoughts about how I wasn't what I should be. And he just used that, just tormented me with that. I knew I needed to come back to God, but I didn't want to come back to God and have my life the same as it was before I left. I knew I would need to be different, and I just didn't think I could be different. And I wasn't letting God help me or the Holy Spirit help
Was the
me.
Devil just fighting you and putting thoughts in your mind to do certain things or just to give up?
Yeah,
or
things weren't good in my home at the time, and I let things get to me, and instead of turning to God, I just felt unloved and felt like nobody needed me. And I had a daughter, though. I had a little girl, and I mean, I got to the point where I was so tormented about not, I wasn't happy out in the world, and I didn't think I could be happy with God, and the devil just tormented me with that so much that I really thought the only way to escape that torment was just to end my life. I mean,
I
got to
that
point.
So you had thoughts of suicide at that point.
I had it all planned out and everything.
So what prevented you from going through with that?
Well, at first I knew if I committed suicide, I would go to hell, number one. I mean, that obviously nobody wants to do that, but then it got to the point where I didn't even care about that anymore. The only thing that I really worried about was my daughter. I just was so fearful that if I did that, what would happen to her? Mm-hmm. And I really think God used that
to get me back on track.
I received a phone call from Reverend somewhere along those lines, from Reverend Angley. And he asked me to come. He said, just, come next Friday to the service. Well, I told him I would, but I didn't. I'd forgotten I didn't go that Friday, but I did go the next Friday. And thank God I did. I came, and he would come down off the platform and pray for people then. And when he came, he prayed for me and, cast those
spirits
of suicide out. And I was born again that night, and it was wonderful, really. He said there was just a little, had gone so far in my thinking, away from God, but there was just a little speck of light in my soul still that God could deal with. And I got set free that night, and it was like, really, that never happened. Mm-hmm. God really brought me out of
And that shows God's mercy for us.
I thank God all the time.
How he loves us and cares about us. And, he doesn't want us to go away from him, but if we fall, he's there to pick us up.
Right, right.
And to comfort us. And I know that there was a great tragedy that you faced later in life that we're going to have you talk about, but we need to take a short break here. So stay with us. We'll be right back.
God really forgive me? Maybe the sins I've committed are just too unforgivable. Have I gone too far? I didn't think God would ever forgive me. But I was wrong. I found Jesus and everything changed. I have a brand new life. Jesus died for my sins so I could be forgiven, so that I could have abundant life, so that I could be made a new creature in Christ. He said he would never remember my sins. He said, though your sins be as scarlet, I will make them white as snow. Don't you want forgiveness for your sins? Come to Jesus today.
And Tammy's going to share with us how she went through a tragedy in her life.
Well, my husband that I was married to first, we were married almost 35 years. Just one night he came home from work, was really, really tired, and we had some things I told him we needed to discuss, but he said he was going to lay down, take a nap first, and maybe he'd feel better. He laid down downstairs. He went downstairs on the couch and laid down, and he was sleeping so soundly, and I knew he was tired, that I just let him sleep. It was evening, and I went ahead and went to bed because I figured he'd probably wake up in the middle of the night and just get showered, and you know, he always came into work early. And when I woke up in the morning, he had passed away in the night. It was really unexpected. He wasn't sick. As a matter of fact, they couldn't even find anything when they did the autopsies. They had no...
You were shocked.
I was shocked. I mean, it was a nightmare. I just couldn't believe that it had happened.
But he was ready to go to heaven.
He was ready. He was ready to go.
I'm glad
he's in heaven safe, you know. But
yeah, when you were going through this and it was so unexpected, I mean, how did you get through all of this?
Well, God, I mean, I was left with a lot of unfinished things. I had two houses that I was, you know, I had to start taking care of. I had a big lawn for one thing, and I never did lawn work, and I had to all of a sudden start learning how to mow the lawn. I was working full time. I was helping raise my grandsons. I was in the choir, you know, and I had a lot on my plate. Finances kind of got really tough with the finances. There was some weeks that I would have $50 from my pay to get me and my grandkids and through the next week. But I mean, it really got tough financially, but God always provided. We always had, I mean, sometimes I didn't know really, I don't think a lot of people knew that at the time, but where my next meal was gonna come from. It got really bad.
So
I had good friends.
You had to really depend on the Lord.
I did.
During this time.
I had friends that helped me out a lot, and my family was really good to me. But I had a lot to do that I just didn't know how to do, and it was so sudden that when you lose somebody, I mean, you lose a part of you. We'd been together a long time, and I just had to really depend on God. And my daughter, it affected her in a great way, and my grandsons, you know. But God helped me, brought me through. And
did you ever think you would remarry?
No. Not. I had so much going on in my life, trying to take care of other things, that I really wasn't even, I didn't have time to even think about that. I know I would, Reverend Angie would speak to me and try to encourage me and help me, you know, to get through some things. And later down the road, years later, he would just kind of say to me, are you interested in anyone? You know, and I'd say, I'd tell him, no. I'd say, I don't have time.
Your mind couldn't even go
there. I said, I don't have time. I don't have time.
So God was going to have to intervene.
Yeah, because he would just say to me, he'd say, well, when the right one comes along, and I'd think, no one's ever going to come along. I was thinking, I had so much on my plate.
Right, you're still treading water.
Yeah, and I didn't know who would really want to take on the responsibility of me and all my package, you know, my burdens. So,
but God did have someone in mind for you, and
he's
sitting right next to you.
Yes, he did. Yeah.
So, Mike, can you share with us the story of how you two started dating?
Well, I it mostly started with her at one point that I didn't even know. I was had been traveling for work, and I came in. I'd known Tammy for years, and we were acquaintances through church. You know, we didn't really run in the same circles, you know, socially or anything like that. But we obviously knew everybody. We're a family at church,
right.
And everybody really knows everyone else. Mm-hmm. But that was the extent of my knowledge.
Yeah, she was your sister in Christ.
Well, I was. I knew he was going through something, but I wasn't sure what. I don't know. God really just laid him on my heart to pray for him during, you know, this time. And I couldn't understand why I felt such a burden for what he was going through. But God just really laid him on my heart to pray for him. And
the Holy Spirit just moved on you.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Yeah.
And that was before I was even interested in anything at that point. You know, I was still going. I'd been traveling. I came back, and the ushers, where they go through, and the choir, when they change from the platform to the other, sometimes we bump into each other, and I...
You're an usher.
Yep, mm-hmm. And I saw Tammy and said hi to her, you know, and acquaintance, and come to find out later that when she did that, she had butterflies in her stomach. And I didn't know anything at that point.
I had been praying for him, and I noticed, because him and his family were always in church. They were there every service. But he was gone for, I think, 2 weekends maybe, and I started to think, maybe he's sick or something, you know, maybe something's wrong. And
he didn't know he was traveling.
I didn't know. So when he came back, and I was coming through the choir room, and I saw him when he came back, all of a sudden, I got butterflies in my stomach, and I just stopped in my tracks, and
I
put my foot down, and I thought, oh, no, we're not going there. We are not going there. There's nothing. We're not doing that. I'm not getting butterflies over this. So I just kind of pushed it out of my mind. And,
so you were kind of resisting a little, even though
a couple people had said something to me. You know how people always are. And mm-hmm. I think a couple people said something to him about me, and were like, just, you know, don't. You know, we're not interested. I don't want to talk about that. We're not going there. So somewhere along the line, I got the idea that people were talking to him about me, and that he was going to think I was stalking him or something. Yeah. So I started avoiding him. Uh-huh. I started avoiding him in the services and sitting elsewhere. So I wasn't in his usher section where he ushers.
And I wasn't ready at that time either.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So there was a service in January of 2016. And I'd gone through quite a lot, and where the Lord moved in for people that had suffered, you know, a lot. And
broken hearts.
And broken hearts and things. And I took that anointing, and that's when my heart was now ready.
It was healed.
It was not. And it was shortly after that we started talking, and we started talking just on the premise, I don't know why people just mind your own business.
I wanted to apologize to him for people saying things to him about me, and he actually apologized to me first for people saying things to me about him. Right. And I said, oh, I'm so glad you said that, because I was going to say that to you, you know. And that was it.
But that started the conversation.
Yeah. At a New Year's Eve day, you know, get together, everybody.
And that was really at that point. The Lord then brought us, so we talked, and it was like, well, that was a lot of fun to talk, and we talked some more, and
at somebody's funeral,
and we chatted for quite a while, and that's where I asked her if she'd like to go to dinner sometime, and that never really worked out, because time came, it's like the the youth service. So the first time we went any place was to one of the youth services.
Oh. And so that was then your first date, going to church.
Right.
Yeah, walking. They did the little march. At the,
oh, you guys marched together?
Yeah, and people were looking at us like, oh, well, I don't even know if Reverend Millar remembers, but I don't know. I thought they were watching us. And
I think that are in your position, would you think everybody's watching them. You know, a lot of times that's not the case, but you know, then there are some people that probably do.
Well, we went right to Reverend.
Yeah,
was our thing.
The very next morning, I said, I need to talk to Reverend. They're like, oh, he already knows. I thought, knows what? We just went out last night for the first time. But when he saw us, he said,
He said, I heard.
Big. Yeah. And he prayed that God would, you know, well, take that love and really make it big. Yeah, It had to be that way. Because of both of our situations, if we had to figure it out, we wouldn't have stayed together.
So God brought you together, and you know, you've been a blessing ever since to us.
Been a blessing.
We'd like to thank you for being on the show. Stay with us because we have more to come.
Losing someone in your life is one of the hardest experiences you will ever have to face. For everyone around you, life continues on. But for you, life has stopped. Even in a world full of people, you feel like you're all alone because that one you love so much is no longer there for you to see, to touch, and to talk to. Jesus will help heal your broken heart. He will put you back together, piece by piece, and give you the strength to live again. Your loved one will always be missed, but the Holy Spirit will comfort you and turn the torment of your loss into beautiful thoughts that will last forever. With Jesus, life can go on in spite of your pain. If you are one who is grieving the loss of someone special in your life, come and visit us at Grace Cathedral and believe for you to find help in your time of need.
Friend, this was a wonderful program, and when you're in God's will, He's going to bless you in a great and mighty way.
So come and be with us at 10 a.m. at Grace Cathedral. We look forward to seeing you. Bye-bye. God bless.
God bless.
Be sure to visit our Grace Cathedral YouTube channel to watch more episodes of Our Grace Family and share them with others so they can also be blessed. And don't forget to subscribe to be notified when new videos become available. If this program has blessed you today, let us know on our Facebook page. You're also invited to attend any of our services. Come and witness the wonderful things of heaven for yourself. This program has been made possible by the friends and partners of Ernest Angley Ministries.